Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Glory to God. Last week, the subject matter was thank God for the harvest. And today's subject matter is thank God simply for being here. It's one thing to get God's promises. It's another thing to get God himself. You can have a promise or you can have his presence. And I know that both things are powerful, but one is most powerful, and that is his presence. Are you satisfied with him being here? When the kids got up and they began to communicate the gospel, I became keenly aware that that is something that we as adults cannot probably do as quickly as they were able to articulate it. But there was a promise connected to going out and communicating that gospel. Matthew 28 says, "Go ye therefore into all the world." And one version says, "And preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe the things whatsoever I've commanded you." And y'all say the next verse, "And don't be jealous, because your name not in the Bible." Say it again, "And Lord." Yes, Lord, thank you. Mine, I'm right up in there. Find your name. I found mine. "I am with you always." I'm up now. "Even until the end." It's as if he's saying, when you go about doing that which I have asked you to do, that's when I'm closest to you. Now, the enemy immediately comes against this idea that God is omnipresent, always there. In fact, if you were to listen to what the enemy is promoting, it's as if he is taking over the world and he's in every home. He's on every radio station. He's in the internet. He's in your job. He's in your dog. He's everywhere. And it's as if the enemy is everywhere, then where is God? Now, the devil is not omnipresent. Now, I know you may have thought, you know, the devil was at my house last night. Girl, the devil was at my house. Oh, he was at my house last night. What time? Three. He was at my house. No, no. Now, he wasn't at that many houses at three. There's one devil. But we will give the enemy that type of credit, but discredit God's ability to be everywhere, solving our problems and challenges. There is a storm brewing, people. And none of us like storms. Storms come for a variety of reasons. There are natural storms like the one that happened in the Philippines. It's a part of the ecosystem of life. The only thing you can do is be aware of it and fortify yourself. There are storms that we bring about on our own because we've decided to do something in opposition to the will or word of God, and it is caused pain. It's my marriage is going wrong, but you haven't done anything that he said you should do in your marriage. I know you want me to get off of that. And then there are storms that come because God has designed them to come to test you. And he likes those storms. The reality that I have to announce to you, you desperately need this sermon today, because there's a guarantee I'm offering. I guarantee you a storm is coming. And you cannot get out of the way. You're going to have to deal with this. And I know it's unpleasant news. Now, if you are going about God's business and the storm hits, you've got some securities in how you can deal with the storm. However, if you're going the opposite way that God has ordained and the storm hits, well, oh my God, you're going to have some calamitous days. It's not so good.
And you might come down for prayer, but what our prayers cannot do is change an unrepentant, disobedient heart that's willing to walk the opposite way that God has ordained. I can't help you with that one. Love you, boo. Now, the lesson last week, Peter was willing to get the greatest catch of his life and walk away for it for the opportunity to get what God loves most, which is people, and learn to become a fisher of men. Go and get God's will. But what Jesus didn't tell him at that moment is that when he was being trained, that all training comes with testing. And with every request of, Lord, promote me, Lord, bless me, Lord, move me forward, advance me in life, I want to be something greater, quite comes with it the opportunity for more storms. So some of us have just asked for it. And it's all right, because we're going to show you how to defeat it, because he is simply here. Now, the problem with him being here is sometimes we forget it, and we forget it very quickly. I told this story some time ago, and many of you know, I have some friends here from Bermuda who were, you know, we were talking about water and oceans and all of that stuff, and some of you know that over the course of my life, my wife and I have had our lives saved 3, 4, 5, maybe 6 times combined out of water, and we don't. When people ask us, can we swim, we want to say yes, but we don't know really how to answer that. Is that correctly? Honey, we don't know how to answer that. I think we can. I can tread, but they don't really count. Doggy, tread, you know. Dog paddle, y'all don't count that for people. Y'all want the real beautiful kind, but I can dog paddle as long as I need to survive. That's swimming, see? Got to count that. That's what the dogs do. That's what I do. I just copied them. I copied them. Okay, so one day in our backyard is a pool at deep end, 9 feet and shallow end, but we were smart enough to stay out of the deep end, but I was just having fun, me and my wife playing around. She was walking on the rope and I was holding her hand, and she accidentally, I don't know how it happened, she slipped out of my hand, she fell into the deep end. She can't swim, remember? I can't swim, remember? And don't be judging me already, because you ain't even heard the whole story. Don't judge me. Don't judge me. You don't want to be judged. Okay. And as she's going over, I say, honey, don't worry. I'm coming. And I jump over the rope. And what I say to myself is, I am going to die, but she is going to live. And I did the best I could. I sunk to the bottom of the pool, and I pushed her out. And I could hear the people on the side of the pool saying, now why he playing with her like that? It don't look like she having fun. Just throwing her out the water like that. I'm thinking, we are really dead. We are so dead. So, eventually, the smallest girl at the pool, her name was Tina Jenkins. She jumps in. She notices that we're in trouble. They pull Debbie out. They don't know that I'm drowning, too. I grab Debbie's foot. I get pulled out. On the side. I'm on the side of the pool. I'm throwing up water. And they begin rebuking me. I can't believe you just almost killed Debbie. And I said, it's true, I did cry like this. It's ugly too. I almost died. I was drowning. I didn't know I was doing. I was playing. I was sorry. I didn't know anyone. I was sorry. I cried the whole day. Because as much as I knew God, as much as I knew his plan for my life, as much as I had rehearsed his word, in the moment of my distress and my trouble, and when it found me suddenly, I didn't even think about him. I didn't call his name. I didn't remember my purpose. I didn't remember his word. I just remembered I'm going to die. It was sudden. And my life flashed before my eyes, and I thought it was over. I wasn't ready for the storm. I thought I was. But it had to come to teach me I wasn't. Now, I was worried he wasn't, because he doesn't forget his word. Even when I do. Oh, let's hurry up and go to Matthew 14 so I can deliver us. Let's go to 14. We're going to go to the 22nd through the 33rd verse. And we're going to discover three things. The first thing we're going to discover in this is that we thank him because he's here, for being here, but we need him. And whether or not we recognize we need him, the next thing is we need to see him. At some point, God, you got to show up for me. Let me see you. And when you see him fully, the only response is submission through worshiping him. You need him. And when you see him in his fullness, oh, how you'll worship him. Because that's the only way your deliverance will really come. Now let's get to that 22nd verse. Jesus has fed the 5,000. In John 6, it says that this crowd is so impressed with this miracle that they actually will want him to be their king. And they're going to try to even attempt to make him king. His disciples, who he is trying to teach the meaning of these revelations or these miracles, are conflicted about what they mean. And he also has heard that John the Baptist, his cousin, has lost his life. And this is where we pick the story up. Immediately, he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. Now, the first thing that makes that particular thing amazing is the same people that were helping him serve 5,000 plus people food. A crowd that we would think would be terribly difficult to manage. He takes his entire staff and says, I can do this by myself. I got it. Y'all go ahead. I want you and I to understand, no matter how much God involves us in his earthly plans, it's never because he needs us. It's simply because he wants us, and from time to time, he reminds us, you know I can do this by myself. He dismisses the crowd. Y'all going to the other side. I've got it. Can you imagine thousands of people? Go to the other side, and while I dismissed the crowd, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray, and when evening came, he was there alone, but the boat by this time had was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. Now, Jesus, I love the fact that in the midst of all that's going on in his life, he still finds time to pray. This is an important feature here. He is demonstrating, remember, he's always training his disciples. The Bible says in Mark, he would get up very early while it was still dark and go to a solitary place and he would pray. He only said and did what the Father showed him. He didn't let the busyness of life, even the peril of life, interrupt his relationship or his need of the Father. Yes, he is fully God, but he is fully man. And he is showing us an imprint or a model of what we should do. And just the same way as Jesus, being the Son of God, would pray, we don't need to presume upon the Lord and fail to pray. He is showing them in the midst of all of this his need of God, and so they didn't understand that they still have a need of him. This first point is we need him, and your need of him and my need of him will never change. And the way you acknowledge that you need him is the way you engage him. And when you fail to engage him, it's a sign back to you that you haven't recognized that you need him. When you're not praying to him, when you're not seeking him first, when you're not acknowledging in all your ways that he might direct your path, when you haven't put him in the preeminent place, the prominent place, then you know that something is off and you're not making a declaration you need him. And in fact, the disciples got in a boat, went to the other side while Jesus was going off to pray. Is if you know that's an activity we're familiar with. We're familiar with boating. We're familiar with sailing. Maybe you can do miracles, but this one we can't handle. How many things in your life have you come to the conclusion that you can handle without God? Because maybe you've done them in the past, or maybe you got your degree in that, and before you start something, you don't even consult him. Being in the room with Dr. Ming Wang when he was doing my wife's eye surgery, when before she was going to lose her eye, he turns to me as a pastor and says, "I need you to pray." I said, "Well, you the surgeon, you good." He said, No. He said, "I'm not that good." He said, "I'm trusting God in everything that I do. You better pray, because if you depended on me, it might not be enough to save her eye. And I'm telling you, she might be blind in one. You better pray that I got enough to make it all the way through this with the wisdom I need to save it." You need him. The first point is you need him. Oh, put that scripture back up. He says, now the boat started beating against it. Now, the disciples at this point have to be thinking they are about halfway on a trip that they understand how to navigate waters, and they're stuck out there being beaten by waves and winds in a storm that they should know how to navigate. And they have to be asking themselves the question, what did we do wrong to deserve this? All I did is what Jesus said. He told me, tell the people to sit down. I did that. He told me, get in the boat. Go on to the other side. I got this. I said, fine, you got it. I got in the boat. I left. Now, my reward is a storm. All right, buddy, Jesus. A storm. Fine. But you don't hear in the midst of the storm them figuring out they need him. You can't hear that they need him. We still got it. You can dismiss the people. We got the storm. We can ride it out. Okay, so here they go. You know, here's the thing. Hey mom, glad you're here. My mom's back, by the way. See her? Wave to people. My mom, when we were young, Pastor Rice would call us in her bedroom and we would sit on her bed and we'd pull out the Bible and we'd go through the scriptures together, albeit the same scripture, same book of the Bible. I hated it. It was Job. Job, and one thing I learned is Job was a praying man. Job was an upright man. Yet when God saw Satan one day going to and fro, he asked him a question. How come in all your going back and forth you hadn't considered my good man Job for some temptation, for some trouble? And he says, "And Lord, you know, you got a hedge around him. Hey, I'm willing to move that. Because I know my man can stand the test. I know what I put on the inside of him. He's not here just to, you know, live out life in a comfortable way. He can take any challenge you throw at him. Just don't kill him. Because he's got a word to live, a long life." All right. I want you to understand that everything Job feared came upon him, the Bible said. The things I feared most came upon me. And he says, and in front of the, and in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them, walking on the sea. This is Jesus. So finally, after all the time they've been spending, the one they need, that they didn't call on,
that they don't seem to be looking for after hours on the sea, said, let me show up so they can see me. See him. He come walking on the sea. Because I know you have limited me to healing the sick. And you thought it was a big miracle for me to get some fish and bread. But I got greater control of the elements than you think. Let me show up. Because I got to give you a greater insight into just how big I am, strong I am, and mighty I am, and just I am, and loving I am, and expansive I am, and eternal I am. I got ahead of myself. Let me read this next verse, 26. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, it's a ghost. Pirates of the Caribbean, in real life. And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, take heart, it is I, don't be afraid. And Peter answered him, Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water. He said, come. So Peter got out of the boat and walked on the water and came to Jesus. Love this. Jesus, in another version, when they saw him and they were afraid of what had been familiar, they were afraid of the very person that had been training them, the very voice that had been nurturing them. Now, fear will cause you to fight everybody around you, even the people that's designed to help you. You start turning on everybody. What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? What's going on? You start seeing stuff. And Jesus, the Bible says, start just walking by the boat. In another version, he said, it's me, y'all. I won't scare you. But God did not give anybody in this room or in life the spirit of fear. But love, power, a sound mind. He's not trying to drive you crazy with a bump in the night. He's not trying to wear you out with, will you make it? Will you not make it? Is your business going to fail? Is it going to succeed? Is your marriage going to make it? Is it going to fail? Always worried. Always confused. No, he's designed you to take his word and speak back to the storm. How do you know? Because in Mark 4, he teaches them the principle of the sower sowing the seed in different grounds, which is the word of God. He tells them how it could be good ground, stony ground. It could be thorny ground. He tells them how the enemy tries to steal the word. Then in Mark 6, he gets in a boat, say, we're going to the other side, falls asleep in the boat. The storm comes. The disciples go and wake Jesus up and say, hey, don't you care that we're about to die? Jesus gets up, rebukes the wind, and then rebukes them for having little faith after the message they didn't hold on to. It's the word he's testing. It's the word he's growing. It's the word he's proving. But without faith, it's impossible to please God. It's impossible to do work for God. It's impossible to advance his kingdom. He's got to develop your faith. He said, you know what? The first time I was in the boat with you, but I'm not going to always be there in that format. You're going to have to know that I'm with you. So I'm going to let you do this storm with me out the boat. But I'll always be just close enough to make sure you win. And when he shows up, Peter, who couldn't remember the first words that should allow him to turn to the storm and speak to it, now turns to Jesus. Is it you? He said, it's I. In this verse, when he said it's I, it's the same as in Exodus 33 when God appeared to Moses and he said, I am that I say I am. He said, yeah, I'm God. I am. I am everything you need, Pete. I am the source. And Pete in this moment says, oh, Lord, tell me to come to you. He's recognizing I don't even need to speak to the storm when you show up.
I don't even need the solution for my boat when you show up. Tell me how to get to you, the great I am. Sometimes we get stuck on the promise and we miss out on the presence. When you get Jesus, you get everything. Peter said, oh, yeah. I'm coming to you. And he gets to Jesus. He gets to Jesus. And that's the prize. He walks on water. He walks on the word. He's winning. He's getting the victory. Yay. But remember, it's a test. And one thing, it wasn't a two-question test. It looked like it had a few more questions left. Let's read final part of this. Next verse. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began to sink. He cried out, Lord, save me. Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took him by saying, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? And when he got into the boat, the wind ceased. Yeah, look at this. He got to Jesus by being unconcerned about the storm. Listen to me. Meditating on the storm would not make it go away. They've been meditating on the storm all night. Did that help them? Oh my God, we're going down. I don't know what's going to happen. Everyone just want to die. Did that help them? No, but that's where we live, right? That's where we live. Your bill's going to bring you down. Everybody think I'm going to bring you down. Mm-mm. No. He got to Jesus. But when you take your eyes off of Jesus and you get back to putting your eyes on the circumstances, the storm, you will never be able to make it. Because it's fixing our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. He that's begun a good work in you, he can complete it. Whatever he started, he can finish. He's the Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. If you begin in the spirit, you can't finish this in the flesh. You can't look away from what the spirit is doing and think now you're going to solve all your problems by earthly means. You started by focusing on Jesus and you're not getting out of this problem by taking your eyes off of him. And to doubt means that he began to be torn between two ideas. Following Jesus is a storm. And you can't do it. This is doubt. And he that doubt is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed. Let this man believe he received nothing from the Lord. Lord, help me. I got you. Peter, come on, man. Why did you doubt? Your little faith. It wasn't just down on you. He's like, man, you almost did it, Pete. He's such an encourager. Don't see it the wrong way. You all, look, you got out there. Why did you doubt, man? That was historic. That was amazing. That was, oh, I wish you hadn't doubted. Because I can't deny my principles for you. I can't do it. Boy, I was so encouraged, though. Let's get in this boat. And immediately, the storm stopped. Because the storm is just a test. Jesus is the reward. And Jesus is the most ignored person in our lives. And that's the problem. Eventually they go to the other side and Jesus begins to heal people and the story goes on. Whenever God has shown up in my life, many times I ask God the question, God, it would be wrong for you to show up like this and then leave me. And he always says the same thing back to me. I won't leave you, don't leave me. I'm here. I want you to stand to your feet. And I'm asking everybody this question today, even you that are up in the upper venue. Everybody's got to ponder something. Everybody's got to consider something the same way. I told you the storm's going to come. But depending upon what your relationship is with Jesus Christ will determine how you weather the storm, if you weather it at all. Whether it might be a storm you created in your own life, Jesus is still willing to pull you out of it. You gotta look to him.
Maybe it's a test. The answer's still the same. You got to look to him. Even in a natural storm of life, you got to look to him. He makes himself the beginning and the end. This life cannot be lived appropriately without you understanding you need him. And then he gives us the gracious opportunity to see him clearly. He's the great I am. He's Lord. And when we do, if we worship him, when they got back in that boat, everybody in the boat began to worship. But you know what? Now we see he truly is the Son of God.
Romans 10 and 9. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I believe this is one of the greatest promises in the entire Bible. And I'd like an opportunity right now to pray with you, and you have an opportunity to receive eternal life. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I need a Savior. I believe that you died on the cross for me. I believe that he raised you from the dead on the third day. And with this confession from my heart, I am saved and I am no longer the same. And Jesus is now Lord of my life. Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer, I am so happy for you. But all of heaven is rejoicing with you. Your next step is to get in a Bible-believing church and allow somebody to help you follow Jesus.